I'm Peter Pitcher, Sheriff of Los Angeles County. As peace officers, our primary purpose is to protect life and property and to combat crime. In order to provide maximum professional service, we constantly encourage the development of new concepts and techniques, along with better and more efficient methods of operation. As an aid in accomplishing our objectives, this motion picture was produced by our department. It is a privilege and a pleasure to share it with you.
What you are seeing here is a crime being committed. Two large juvenile delinquents have ambushed a doctor and are attacking him. The motive? To steal narcotics. Fortunately for this doctor, an alert police officer happens upon the scene while the crime is being committed. Notice that this police officer goes for his baton, not his gun, as he interrupts the criminal actions of these juvenile lawbreakers. Watch. The baton, properly used, has enabled this officer to survive an attack, to counterattack, and to disable his opponents temporarily without causing severe or permanent injury. The officer is firmly in control of the situation as he handcuffs the two youths together, then searches them for concealed weapons. The regulation police baton, like a firearm, a uniform, and a badge, often acts as a deterrent to violence and disorder. Sometimes, however, no symbol of law and order will act as a deterrent. And then, as this officer has ably demonstrated, the baton is a valuable law enforcement tool. Without having had to draw his gun, the officer remains firmly in command of the situation as he radios a two-man patrol car to take the youths into custody. Assistance is on the way, and until it arrives, the officer is firmly in command of the situation. Now that we have seen what a law enforcement officer, properly trained, can do with a baton, let's take a closer look at this important police tool. A baton is made of hard wood, smooth sanded, and stained with natural wood colors. It is cylindrical in shape, 26 inches long, and 1¼ inches in diameter. Both ends must be rounded. The weight of the baton must not be less than 12, no more than 18 ounces. A baton may not be weighted or loaded in any manner. The grip of the baton consists of 8 longitudinal grooves, each 5½ inches long, 1/4 inch wide, and 1/8 inch deep. These grooves must be located 1¼ inches from the grip end of the baton. A thong hole, 3/16 inch in diameter, must be located 9½ inches from the grip end of the baton. A leather thong is threaded through this hole so as to form a loop 30 inches in circumference. The ends of the thong are threaded through the hole in opposite directions and secured by knots, as shown. To grasp the baton properly, place the thong loop over the thumb with the thong against the back of the hand. Rotate the hand to the thumb-high position so that the baton is suspended by the leather thong. There should be about 1/4 inch clearance between the hand and the end of the baton. If necessary, adjust the thong for proper clearance. With proper clearance, rotate the palm counterclockwise and grasp the baton firmly so that the butt end of the baton extends about 1¼ inches beyond the edge of the hand. The thumb should be placed parallel to the longitudinal grooves. When held in this manner, the baton will not fly from an officer's hand in combat. Yet the officer may release the baton, if necessary, simply by relaxing his grip and straightening his fingers. If an officer has reason to expect trouble, he should assume the ready position. This is done by standing erect, feet about shoulder width apart, body weight distributed evenly on both feet. The tip end of the baton is placed in the left hand, palm up, and the baton is held firmly with both hands. The arms are now relaxed, allowing the baton to rest against the front of the legs. It is not good practice for an officer to raise and lower the tip end of his baton or to slap it in the palm of his hand. These motions have no real psychological value. The basic combat position for using the baton is the port arms position. An officer standing at the ready position moves easily into the port arms position by sliding his left foot forward, bending his knees slightly, and raising the baton up in front of his chest, angling the baton from the left shoulder down toward the right hip. The grip end of the baton, in the right hand, is held about at waist level. The right forearm is held parallel to the ground, with the right biceps close to the body. The tip end of the baton is held shoulder high in the left hand, palm up. The left forearm is held at an angle which places the baton 6 to 8 inches out in front of the body. The officer's weight is evenly distributed on both feet. Both his hands grip the baton firmly, with no more than 1.25 inches of the baton extending beyond either hand. The port arms position allows ease of movement while engaging an opponent, but makes it difficult for the baton to be wrestled from the officer's grasp. Here we see a move from the ready position into the port arms position, and then up into the high port position, a variation of the port arms. The high port position is used to block overhead thrusts or blows from an opponent. A variation of the high port position is seen here. Held parallel to the ground at throat level, the baton provides an officer with leverage to help force a crowd back. Here we have a third attack position, the on guard. A position somewhat similar to offensive stance. The body is turned toward the left, and the right foot is moved forward about 12 inches, pointing toward the opponent. The left foot is placed perpendicular to the right, and the right knee is bent slightly for good balance. The baton is held in the right hand in the regulation manner. The right biceps held close to the body, and the right forearm parallel to the ground. The baton is held at an angle, pointing toward the opponent's throat. There are three basic methods of attack with a baton, and of course, variations and combinations of these three. The first is the chop, or cut, delivered either from the port arms position or the on guard position. Notice that from either position, the officer puts his weight behind the blow, stepping forward in the direction of his opponent and striking a short, chopping blow. Notice, too, that after the blow, the officer steps back quickly to his original attack position. He does not telegraph any of his movements. The second basic method of attack is the jab, usually delivered from the port arms position. In using the jab, the officer makes certain his body weight is behind the blow and that the tip of the baton strikes a vital area on his opponent's body. After each jab, the officer quickly recovers to the port arms position. The third basic method of attack is the thrust, a very effective technique for close-in fighting. Starting from the port arms position, the officer places the tip end of his baton in his opponent's solar plexus or under his ribs. Then, by moving his body forward, the officer applies pressure to his opponent by forcing the baton forward and upward. If necessary, an officer can move the tip end of the baton up and down in a grinding motion over his opponent's ribs. There are many combinations of these three basic methods of attack, and like combination punches in boxing, they can be extremely effective. But before we consider additional baton techniques, it is best that we become thoroughly familiar with the various impact points of the human body.